want to talk about the gender say gap. Have you heard that term before? Coined by Claire Mason. You're going to hear more from her in a little bit. But I want to bring in my guests that are going to help us find our voice, particularly our authentic voice, how to speak up in the workplace, how to, I suppose, overcome that fear, perhaps, that some women have of speaking up. Let me introduce to you, they're going to come across your screens as well as we continue with our BBC's 100 Women. We have Deepa Narayan, a social scientist and author of the insightful Chup, Breaking the Silence About India's Women. I love that title, Deepa. I'm going to get you to explain in just a moment, but I also want to bring in Alma Arzate. She was born in Mexico, but now named one of Canada's most inspirational women 2020. Really curious about making that cultural shift from Mexico to Canada. A lot to learn as well in the workplace about speaking up. And we also have Inam Azyama. Maybe you are familiar with her already as an influencer and an activist, really using her platform on behalf of others to help them find their voice. It's wonderful to have all of you with us. But apart from my guests that are here, I have you with me. Maybe you want to get involved. Maybe you want to give us a comment or a question. There are a number of ways to do that at BBC 100 Women, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, also BBC 100 Women, or the World Service YouTube channel. So no shortage of ways to get in touch. We'd love to add your voice to this conversation that we're going to have. Deepa, wonderful to have you with us. You know, I mentioned your book, Chup, there, which, how would you translate it? I saw a few different translations online.
The one I love is shut up. It means be quiet. And it's a word that's used so much in India, in North India, that it's actually become an English word. It's in the English Oxford Dictionary now. And I used it as the title of my book because it so summarizes the experiences of women in being deleted and being cut off and being minimized. And that, of course, includes the voice, which is such a major part of who we are as human beings. So I thought it was appropriate to have something dramatic.
It is. And it stopped me and it made me go and try and understand more what that word meant. But getting at your research, Deepa, I mean, why do you think women perhaps don't speak up in these various spaces that we're going to explore in this masterclass in the way that they could?
I think the framing is really important, that not speaking up is a habit, and a habit is just a habit, and that women have been trained for years and years and years and decades not to speak up. But so it gets wrapped up in shame. And so if we drop the shame and realize it's not our fault, it's just training, and we're not defective, half the battle is won. And then, of course, realizing that you're not alone, so you don't need to hide. So the moment you open up, the fear starts to disappear, and it's fear and pretense that keeps us not hearing our voices, not speaking up, and not making our voices heard. So it's not a personal defect. That's the most important message.
I understand. And when you looked at your research, just briefly, Deepa, how many women do you think this effects at the circles you were looking at?
I would dare to say everyone. And if you listen to Michelle Obama, she talks about being afraid of speaking up to her visitors in the White House. If you think about Elizabeth Warren was sweating and couldn't speak just before she went on to the Colbert show. In fact, it was so bad that she had to have drinks of water. But then once she started speaking, she was so brilliant that she was invited over and over again. But so I think it's really, really important to acknowledge fear and to learn how to manage fear. Because fear is because we've been trained not to speak up. And if you've been trained not to speak up, you're breaking a rule. And so everything starts working against you.
Okay.
So that's what I train, teach in Chup circles, which is a direct outshoot of the book in in getting women together and doing fun games, activities, so women can relax and have fun and not be so afraid.
Well, I was about to ask you, so you've answered my question. I like the idea of that, of kind of games or activities or role play to try and break that fear, because it is really breaking it, I think I'm hearing you say, because once you get
exactly
through that first part, it becomes right easier. You know, I mentioned Claire Mason at the beginning of this session because she coined that phrase, the gender say gap. She's the founder of Man Bites Dog. So I want to bring a little off Claire to you and to our viewers, and then we'll pick up on what she says.
Did you know that for the last decade, women have outnumbered men in high status professions? Women are entering universities across the world in record numbers, and today there are more university educated women in the workforce than men. But there's a problem. We still lag behind men in pay and in power. This divide is a symptom of a much bigger issue that I've coined the gender say gap. This gender gap calls attention to the invisibility of women in business and in every walk of public life. It highlights the challenges we face in using our voices and making our ideas heard, and the consequences for women and society if we remain silent. The bottom line is the next generation of women can't be what they can't see. And everywhere you turn, the female experts are missing. I first noticed the gender say gap when I was working on an important campaign for a management consultancy to persuade governments and employers to reskill their employees for the digital revolution. When it came to taking our ideas to market via media interviews and conference speeches, the expert women consultants who had contributed so much didn't step forward. Instead, two men volunteered and did a great job of sharing our campaign with the world. They recognized the opportunity and they seized it, even though they were less well qualified to speak on the subject. I started to notice that this was a pattern of behavior, that in business and in public life, so many women are missing out on the opportunity to advance their ideas, their causes, and their careers, because we fear, justifiably, that we will be unfairly criticized. And therefore, we just don't speak up. We must demand equal opportunity, but we must also be brave enough to seize that opportunity. I wanted to persuade female experts to step forward from a place of real understanding. So I set out to campaign for say equality by leading by example and learning to speak out myself. And let me tell you, it has been quite an adventure. Let's face it, public speaking is probably the most terrifying thing you can do in your professional life. So I enrolled in a public speaking course, which culminated with me standing on the top of a wobbly stepladder in gale force winds in famous London debating spot Speaker's Corner. I withstood the hecklers there for 10 very long minutes. And do you know what? Nothing they said was anywhere near as harsh as my own inner critic. Once I had faced my fears, I needed practice. So I set myself the challenge of saying yes to every single speaking opportunity that came my way for an entire year. I can now stand here and say that I've presented nearly 100 talks on subjects from the gender say gap to entrepreneurship to climate change, in places from the UK Houses of Parliament to New York's Times Square. I know the change I want to make in the world, so now I ask for opportunities to promote my ideas and my cause, and I connect other people with opportunities so they can have their say too. If we want to live in a world where women are equally represented, where media and conference organisers can't say that all the women they asked to speak said no, we need to put our hands up and volunteer, because that is the only way we can bridge the gender say gap.
Claire Mason there, thanks very much to her. Brings up a lot of issues. What a brave lady to go to Speaker's Corner. I don't know if you know London, but you're kind of quite exposed there and you will get heckled, but that's what she decided to do. I want to bring you to some details. This is a Women in the Workplace survey. 68,000 employees found that half of the women they asked had experienced being interrupted or spoken over. 38% had others taking credit for their work. Let me bring in Alma Arzate. Great to have you with us, Alma. I'm just wondering, is that something you have experienced in the workplace of perhaps not being heard? And how did you overcome it?
Oh, absolutely. I recall one of the key challenges that I had to overcome at the beginning of my career to find my voice was related to my male coworkers taking my ideas during meetings, repackaging them, presenting them again, and getting the recognition like they have been their ideas all along. As you can imagine, you know, it was quite frustrating, right? So, but you know what? I said, I have a role to play too. This is being done to me because I'm allowing it. So I decided to take some personal accountability and change my approach, you know? So tried to connect with my peers before the meeting so I could gather their support and listen to see if I could understand any concerns they might have. And during the meeting, if someone challenged me, I tried to avoid becoming defensive, tried to remain open-minded, considering that maybe they had a valid point to what they were saying. So took a moment to gather myself, presented more facts to the table, and if my idea was still not accepted, I just didn't dwell on it. I moved on, and the more I practiced, I would say the more confident I grew, and the more confidence made me more comfortable, and that made me also more effective.
I'm wondering, Alma, as well, though, because you said you were like looking at your peers and trying to figure out, I suppose, your authentic voice. You are in a male-dominated workplace culture, I think it's fair to say. Do you think there is a different way that a woman may be communicating than a man in those spaces?
Yes, and I think it goes back to what you just said. We have to be authentic. We have to be our own self. And the sooner we realize that, the better it's gonna be for all of us, because a lot of people are watching us. And when we come from a place of empathy and authenticity, I think it resonates with people and they're more willing to listen to what we have to say. So definitely part of finding my voice was not to imitate someone else, but more like take a page from their book and see what kind of qualities were making them effective into selling their ideas and then adapt those into my own style, you know, so I could still be myself and I could still be true to my values and what I believed.
Really interesting. I want to go back to you, Deepa. Some of those issues that Alma has raised, I know they have crossover with what you have studied. I'm really curious as well about women in a space with men trying to speak up or overcome that fear. Do you think that's different if it was women with women?
Absolutely. Because if you think about the training, if men are given the power and women are supposed to be quiet, then when you confront power, there is fear. And this is, again, something women don't like to talk about because it doesn't make us look good. It doesn't make us feel good because you're highly educated, successful. Why should you have this fear? But again, acknowledging the truth, if it's true for you, really sets you free. And so when you know you're going into a meeting with a lot of men, we have to prepare. And we have to, so my acronym for dealing with this behavior is what I call, cheekily called prick. So it's prepare and practice. Then you have to relax, otherwise the fear comes up, and have some personal practices, whether it's deep breathing, whether it's pumping yourself up to music. And I is intent, holding an intent to speak up and being very, very intentional and insistent. And C is congratulating yourself, celebrating and comparing your own performance with yourself, not with anybody else. And that's the only way to be authentic, because each one of us has a unique perspective, a unique way of talking, a unique way of speaking up. And the world really needs this different voice because we are a mess. And so women we have to conquer our fear if there is fear. We have to manage our fear and still speak up. It doesn't matter if you're shivering and shaking. What's important is that you speak up. It's a muscle that we've been trained not to use. So like a muscle, like swimming, like building up your biceps, it's just training. And the more you practice, the more automatic it becomes.
Really good advice there. Very practical tips. I like that. We're actually going to have a session later on in BBC 100 Women about the music, the tunes that can get you empowered, get you going, make you feel confident. Wonderful. So stay with us for that. But I think it's tying into some of the issues Deepa's bringing up there. Inam, I want to come to you. You've been hearing a little bit from Alma, from Deepa, really, I suppose, a more traditional workplace, shall we say. But, you know, you are somebody who is an expert online, the way that people use their voices there. And I just want to bring a couple of figures. Some people say it can be the most hostile place to be a woman is online. Plan International, they're a humanitarian organization. They work in more than 70 countries, really working for equality for girls. They looked into online abuse experienced by young women. They asked more than 14,000 girls. 58% of respondents said they had experienced online violence. Many then that really decide to leave that space or their social media feeds for fear of being targeted. It must take incredible courage to speak up. And how have you found that courage?
It's a really special thing being able to find a community online. And I do resonate with so much that has been said in terms of, you know, having to suffer this abuse and, you know, wanting to walk away from certain situations because you're so worried that, like, it can ripple into something that could be physical in person. I believe that there's a real need to actually represent so many people. And with me, I'm representing so many different intersections. I'm representing a Black, queer, fat woman, women all over the world. And that is the greatest reward for me, being able to be, you know, to focus on those different communities and those different intersections and know that you're doing great stuff for them. And for me, my workplace is mainly being a model. And there's so much structure that's being built within that community at the moment. And that is the real focus, and that's the real joy that I'm having to work on, because I'm getting to have conversations with, you know, from the makeup artist to the photographer. That goes beyond body image, that goes beyond race, as to what systems that can be put in place to make more people feel inclusive and love themselves. So a lot of what I do actually it's about brain training, essentially, because which I agree with Deepa about, it's about having these habits where you can stay positive and you can actually be willing to push past all the negativity that you see online and find the right mentors and find the right communities to actually support you through all the adversities that you feel on a constant basis, because nobody's ever going to love the way that you look. No one is ever going to love the things that you say, but it's actually taking that risk and being like, I don't care what you say, I'm actually going to stand up for myself, because no one else around you is going to do that.
It's really interesting, and I'm just thinking through a couple of aspects as you talk, and you talk about that brain training. But the minute you're out there, particularly with an image, as you have been as well, as you talk about modeling, there are going to be people who feel they can comment on what you say or what you do. And it must be a difficult line to walk about taking on any constructive criticism that there might be with an exchange of ideas, just like the way we're exchanging right now, and knowing when somebody is being negative and that you need to, you know, block them or whatever it might be. In the way that you deal with them. How do you decide to do that? How are some tips, I suppose, to be able to stay positive, stay strong while you're online and being able to interact with others?
So I suppose my technique is very much ignore. it's a very age-old technique. If you see something that doesn't feel you so positively, walk away from it. And I'm so happy that over the years, Instagram has been where I perform the most is Instagram. I've been able to put things in place that can allow you to minimize the way in which to actually be selective about what comments come through on your feed, and being able to minimize the words that I use. So if someone is constantly using, you know, the fat word and you're not comfortable with that, you can actually put that word, you can actually remove that word from comments, and that if anyone comments about stuff like that, you don't have to see it, because, you know, we are dealing with traumas here. The way in which people feel about them, their bodies, and the way in which people receive compliments and receive and feedback or opinions about themselves is not really structured, and you never know what triggers, you know, are going to be felt when there's so many people in the world who are telling you how they feel about you. And so for platforms like Instagram to do stuff like that has been super helpful. Also, you can prioritize your page if things get too much for you, which I know a lot of my friends have had to do because of the trolling. And recently I was, you know, I had to face that. And to be honest, the best way for myself to do so was I had to actually really talk to a lot of my friends offline and be like, you know, this is the situation that's happening. And they were actually able to extend the support using their platforms, you know, through their stories and through their grids, and actually talk about the issue and be like, you know, something that was meant to be a positive situation by a brand sharing my a project that I've been a part of, you know, someone has made a whole thread about it and talking about how I'm, you know, perpetuating all these, you know, negative health, negative health risks. And so many people around me were able to band together and actually use their voices and stand up for this and tell people that, you know, this is just about, you know, my page is solely for the purpose of bringing people together and making people actually have authentic conversations about their bodies and how they really feel about it, and that we're going to only uplift each other. And if my page doesn't work for you, there are many people out there that can help you do that.
You know, the thing I'm hearing from all three of you is about having a support network, whether it was Alma going in and speaking to people before the meeting that she was concerned about to have that. I'm also hearing it from Deepa and from you, Inam, as well. Different spaces, but I think some of the same tips. So all of those are really useful. Deepa, I want to come back to you and I want to get Alma's input on this as well. But let me begin with Deepa. We talked about the workplace. Let's talk about home. Those difficult conversations that we sometimes avoid, maybe having with those even near to us, you know, finding our voice. Maybe that's harder than work. I don't know. Deepa, what tips would you have for people that want to broach difficult topics with those near and dear to them?
It's very interesting that you ask this, because there are two kinds of people. But a lot of people find their mouths close when they're with people they love, because there's more to lose, or they feel that there's more to lose. So I think it's really important to distinguish between position and interest. So what we get stuck with is positionality, right? Instead, what is my deeper need underneath what I'm asking for? And being able to say it in a way that doesn't attack the other person. Because when people feel shamed or attacked or humiliated or made wrong, they automatically go into defense, just like we would. And when there's that defense in front, the love shuts down and the brain shuts down and the other person is locked into fear. So you have two people locked into fear trying to move towards love and solution. It just doesn't work. So I would use the same principle of prepare, relax, be very clear on your intent. And once you've spoken, congratulate yourself. And part of relaxing is slowing down. So you're not in a verbal match. You're in a verbal conversation to try and listen really deeply to each other. And I think when that happens, as part of an anthropologist, when I do the research, people just talk. It's like a dam opening up, because most people don't feel heard. And I think that's especially true in love relationships or in parent-child relationships, because we're most afraid to speak our truth to people we love, because we have so much more to lose, or we are afraid that there's so much more to lose. But the principles are the same. The intensity of emotion may be different at work and at home. And it may switch around depending on the issue and what's at stake.
Let me bring in Alma on that. Really, I suppose, that aspect of how do you deal with conflict?
Yeah, well, as Deepa was talking, I was picturing a hot topic in the workplace, which is some of our managers don't feel comfortable having open and honest conversations with employees in giving them feedback if their behaviors in meetings are still not where it's supposed to be. And there's a book that I read many years back called Fierce Conversations, which goes back to Deepa's comment of preparing. You have to prepare yourself for these conversations because in reality, they're very difficult. You know, you're telling someone that that person needs to continue to improve and continue to develop, but you need to do it with compassion. You know, even at work, you have to maintain those relationships. And you want that person, as a people leader myself, and I've been a people leader for over 15 years, I want my people to continue, the team that reports to me and maybe even other peers, to continue to grow and do well. And that conflict, dealing with that conflict where, you know, you need to ask for permission to say, you know what, I want to have this conversation with you. And I want to make sure like it comes across the right way. This is what I have. Will you be open to some feedback? And usually, you know, people are very open and they're like, yeah, sure. Tell me how can I do better? How can I improve? And that's kind of the spirit of I care about you and I want you to do better. And this is what I have observed, kind of remaining factual. And this is what I will suggest, you know, for you to continue to develop those skills. And I will say that probably I'm going to venture that 95 times over 100, it goes really well. Those five, maybe not so much, but you know, you can only do what you can, right? So just putting it out.
They're really good. They're really good batting averages, as they would say in the States right now. Oh, so we'll take so that. And I think that is, I think you're breaking down those barriers by saying that you care about the person. I want to bring in some of the comments. You've been getting in touch with us on Twitter, on Instagram, Facebook, and also on our YouTube channel on the World Service. Carol, I've been watching, listening to the BBC 100 Women Masterclass. It's fascinating. So many amazing women talking about things from money, climate, talking to our kids, so much helpful information. Our women are helping us find our authentic voice. Sina Foley on Facebook, love it, good practical tips. That's right. And Aisha Khan says, I've felt totally inspired and reinvigorated with this live stream. Thank you, ladies. I want to turn to something that Alma was getting to there, and I want to bring you in, Inam, on this, about respect in conversations, because so many people do butt heads, particularly online. Some people just don't even have a filter, it seems, or realize that they're speaking to a real live person. Does trying to deal with those conflict-ridden situations make it harder to stay in your authentic voice?
Yeah, I suppose it definitely also has an effect on you because you're having to deal with this conflict. Identity is such a huge topic, and especially for our generation and us being so young, being so young and accessing the internet, you're having to deal with so many people's opinions of you whilst building your own. And that is such a huge thing to actually work on, like self-actualization from such an early age. So for me, when I see something that I feel is negative, the first thing if I feel like there's something that I disagree with, my first thing is not to just, you know, attack. My thing is also sit and see how this person's opinions can actually have a different perspective. And it's through having to have friends who, like that community that I spoke about earlier, and having those conversations with them. So if I don't feel like I need to have this conversation with the person directly, can I have this conversation with other people and pose this question to a group of people that I trust and who can have this honest conversation with me? And that is basically what I would say. In terms of conflict, that will always be a thing. Especially when you're speaking online, because nobody's actually seeing your facial expressions, no one is seeing your body language. So there's so much room for interpretation. But what I found with my online space is that I come with the education and I come with my perspective and I come with my knowledge of my heritage, that the first thing that I do is that I spell out what my experiences are and what it feels true to me, as opposed to talking for other people. And I think that online, oftentimes with my community and the intersex that I'm a part of, the conflict comes greatly from misunderstanding or people over talking and trying to explain your stories and trying to explain your experiences for you. And it's very triggering, and it plays on a lot of generational trauma, which is quite scary, because you never want to feel as if you're in a space where someone else is telling your stories for you. And that's where most of our conflict come from.
Really interesting to think about that and how you might be able to diffuse or think about that conversation just away from that person who is directing something at you. Alma, you know, Ina, when she was bringing up some of those points, it made me think of, yes, sometimes you don't see the person online, but now we see each other, like we are looking at each other right now, on Zoom so often. And now that we're in this pandemic, living our lives through screens, so to speak, how do you think that changes the picture, or what should people be aware of as they try to find their voice, get their opinions across in this slightly strange setting, some would say?
Well, it's definitely a strange setting, and none of us has to be here. So we were actually talking about it the other day at work, and my boss actually is the one who's like, 8 months have passed since the last time we saw each other in person. Because we were sent home in the middle of March, and I was able to, you know, get my laptop and my monitor, my keyboard, my ergonomic chair, which I really needed, and go home. And that was the last time I saw my team in person, you know. And I guess we'll see. We'll start with, we're on this together, you know. We're all kind of thrown into this boat and trying to make the most out of it. And the Zoom meetings, we're trying to engage the video. Because I think, and you said it and said it really well, when you're interacting online, and I have my community, is in LinkedIn, so I have a 20,000 following, or plus 20,000 plus. So that's the community I interact with. But it's really difficult because they're not looking at you. They're not seeing your facial expressions, and I'm kind of a lively person anyway. But, you know, I want to see how people are reacting to what I'm saying. So in terms of team rules or so, I have a monthly team meeting and in Zoom, so 23 of us with my own team, and all of us from video, you know, and we all give a bit of an update on what's happening across the business. And sometimes we just, you know, play fun games. I think we were playing, a bit of a game the other day, you know, just to try to keep that human connection, you know. It doesn't have to be all about work, and I encourage that, you know, like if you want to just book 15 minutes for a coffee chat, we miss those interactions when my office door was open, people could come in at any time. I was eating, so I'm eating and people are talking to me, but you know, that's the only time I had available. So I miss those connections. So we now need to be very intentional, you know, when we need to connect with people. And that's, we have to plan for it, basically.
Yeah,
they're crazy.
I'm wondering as well, you know, if some of the things that we have been trying to think about or perhaps work on, and Deepa, I want to come back to you on this. there's the term microaggressions that my guests are probably very aware of, but it was a term I think coined in the 70s, kind of small, subtle actions, remarks, facial expressions that can make us kind of, I suppose, pull back, bend down and away from taking part in a conversation, that we feel we are being somehow attacked, even though it's very, very, very subtle. I wonder how much you feel that influences us finding our voice, and also how this works in this online world right now, Deepa.
Right. No, you're absolutely right, Joan. I think the research is showing that all our prejudices or how we judge people in real life transfers completely to online. And because there are even fewer cues, that women who are not used to speaking up, or people who are used to interrupting, it doesn't go away. In fact, it becomes even more real, because it's you feel trapped in a box. So the way to overcome that is to do all the things that we've been talking about, which means that you prepare beforehand, you dress up if that gives you confidence, you get a good mic which amplifies your voice. So use the technology to amplify your voice so you don't get interrupted and your voice comes through. One of the messages that I've been getting, reading from the research, is that it's really important to give people feedback from your facial expression. So smiling a lot, you know, raising your thumb, supporting others so that you change the environment at Zoom, again, bringing more positive reinforcement rather than negative, or again, breaking the environment of fear. So I loved what Claire said. You've got to practice, relax. And then if you've been able to speak up and say what you need to say and be heard, or keep repeating what you've said till you get heard, then it's time to congratulate and celebrate.
I love that idea of congratulating yourself on something that you did well. What about you? You know, if there is somebody who feels they don't have the skills and experience to go in and take command of a room where they want to get their idea across, what would be your top two tips to do that?
Well, Rome wasn't built in a day. So I have to say that now it feels like we're all very comfortable and so, but even coming to this session, I have to confess, you know, I was also having butterflies in my stomach. So it doesn't really matter where you are, you know, in your career, you're always going to have that a little bit of, you know, nervous energy. So try to channel that, you know, to fuel your performance, you know, and kind of that adrenaline that is coursing through my veins, you know, at the moment. Try to make sure that it comes across as, you know, you come across as passionate and engaged into the conversation. So that will be one of them. The butterflies, the nervousness, unless I think we were talking about Michelle Obama, or crying out loud. So it's probably not going to go away. So just try to channel that. And because practice makes perfect, although no one, please don't aim for perfection, you know, but that's practice. Is skill is like the skill of speaking up is like any other skill. It can definitely be developed. None of us were born, you know, speakers, especially, right? But so keep practicing, you know, and if you start practicing in a bit of a safe, low risk environment, you can keep pushing your limits from there, you know, and you might not get it right the first time, but don't worry, keep persevering, keep practicing. And you know, and I would say the last comment in that is like, as women, we need to watch our level of passion, because I was talking about passion. Because too much passion, you know, and I don't know, Deepa and Anna, maybe you have seen it, but I was like, oh, she's too emotional. She's not rational because she's, you know, we come across as too passionate. But on the other hand, when you're too deadpan, it can get your message go unheard, and or you might be seen as an uninspiring leader. So you want to be in command of your emotions. You want to appear in command of your emotions. So trying to be watchful of your tone, your pitch, your timing, and your body language. If you have a friend in the room, you might want to rely on that person, that mentor, that advisor, and said, watch me as I'm presenting. What kind of feedback can I get, you know, from you? You know, so that kind of rely on someone else in the room to provide you kind of a bit of an unbiased feedback.
Yeah, it's really interesting. I think it keeps coming back to having this network that I think men often had, particularly within workplaces, and perhaps that women did not. So some of us still figuring out exactly what that circle looks like. I want to bring a comment that came into us. It is talking about gathering the courage to face the rejection that will come when we say what we actually think, when we think it. That is from Nikki Cicero on Facebook. Thanks very much for your comment coming in there. I think I'm coming back to you, Inam, again, because, you know, online it often is you're saying what you actually think, and trying to have courage to deal with the rejection. I mean, have you ever felt rejected? We've heard there from Alma, you know, still every time she gets to speak, she, you know, gathers up that nervous energy and puts it forward in a wonderful, confident display. Do you still feel rejected at times when you put something out there, and how do you deal with that?
It's so interesting. I really love everything that has been said, because like, this is really my avenue, because, you know, there's a great, this great feeling that you get from rejection for me personally. There's so many avenues in what I've done that I've been told that I'm not good enough. You know, I'm never going to be able to be, to set the standard for so many aspects of when it comes to beauty. And my, like, what I do is based around rejection, to say, like, for lack of better words. And for me, the best thing that I've been able to do from that has been to create my own projects. Because as a model, you're going to go on set and someone is going to have an idea of how they want to, you know, to fix you up and create a look on you, and you're not going to like it, but you have to keep going forward and you have to keep pushing through. And then you, sometimes you have to go to castings and you're so, you want to work with this brand. You're like, oh my God, it's going to be perfect. Or you send in a casting tape and you're like, this is going to be the job of my life, and you don't get it. So working from those things and understanding that you're not always going to get what you want has actually really pushed me to be the person to be like, how can I create my own projects for myself? Yeah. And so that is 100% what I would encourage everybody to do. Do not wait for other people to validate what you're going to do for yourself, that you can easily do for yourself. You know, for me, it's been working on projects like with my friends, telling them, let's meet up, let's create our own content, let's put a hashtag behind it, let's put a caption behind it. More recently, one of the things that I've been trying out is poetry. You know, I'm taking all this information that I'm reading from books, because there's so many books out there that address microaggressions, by the way. There's so many forums online as well that you can also read upon, you know, that address microaggressions. And it's really about understanding what microaggressions look like. And some of the microaggressions that I face, you know, as a Black person, is from people, you know, picking out the hair, my hair, always questioning, you know, oh, you're like, oh, is that a new hairstyle? Oh, has your hair grown long? You know, it's the little subtle things, as you mentioned, you know, that can really create this giant ball of stress. That's the best word, because you're going into work so tense. And so I've taken all this knowledge and I've taken all these feelings and emotions that I have, and I no longer see as rejection, but as an opportunity for growth and as an opportunity to start something new for myself, or set a new standard.
I love that. I'm going to take that as your tip, Inam, to find your voice.
Well,
so
done.
Take that rejection and turn it into an opportunity. Alma, I'm back at you. If you were to give our viewers one tip, your top tip to find their voice, what would it be?
Don't be afraid, you know, jump. Both feet into the water. You have a lot of people that care about you. You might know it or you might not know it, but you have a lot of friends and a lot of allies. And I try to be that ally for my people, you know, the people that I work with at Apotex. And I watch over them, you know, and I've been telling them, I will not let you fail. You know, so we're in this together. So you have advocates, you have allies, you have mentors, you have advisors. So tap into that network, as we were talking about, and some of your network might be male, you know, or female. It doesn't matter. We need the support of both to be successful. You know, we don't want to alienate the other half of the audience. Hopefully they're watching. So yes, try it. The more you try it, the more the confidence is going to grow, and the better your confidence, the better everything else is going to become, the easier it becomes. I'm not saying it's going to be easy. That's exactly what we were talking about. It's never easy. Prepare to be uncomfortable and embrace that uncomfortability and that failure, that feeling of failure. But when success comes, and there are going to be many, take the time to celebrate those successes. And we
Alma,
try.
Thank you so much. Also celebrate. I just want to give Deepa 30 seconds, your top tip
right
to find your voice.
if you find yourself ruminating about something, obsessing about something, it means you haven't spoken up. So the way to clear your mind and be creative and have fun is to speak up so your mind is not obsessing with what you didn't say. And research shows that women ruminate. So don't ruminate, speak up. Don't waste your life energy. And create your path in small ways every day. It actually becomes a lot of fun. If you frame it as a challenge and fun.
Deepa, thank you so much. I think framing it as fun is a wonderful way to do it. I've had fun over the past 45 minutes with my guests, Deepa, Alma, and Inam. You can find out more about them, of course, on our BBC 100 Women page. Also on our hashtags. We're on Twitter, we're on Instagram, we're on Facebook, we're also on YouTube on that World Service channel.